Good morning, Dexter Lake. How are we this morning? Go ahead and stand on your feet and join us in the altar if you feel comfortable doing that. We know that the scripture says that if we lift him up, that he would draw all men unto him. Amen. So this morning, I just invite you to lift the Lord up. Amen. Heaven is all around. Let's bring heaven into this place this morning.
Longing for earthly pleasures, you broke. Your just a second. Here's what I want to do this morning. I want to intermingle. I'm getting in dangerous territory right off the bat. I want to intermingle your faith together with some logic. I know the two just, they're like oil and water. But I got to intermingle some faith together with some logic in your life. Here's the thing. Faith is the evidence of things hoped for. Help me out, Jesus. Substance, that's what it is, the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. And so logic doesn't really go with that very well. We don't usually put faith and logic together. But here's what I love about the lyrics of this song. My logic tells me if something's been done before, it can be done again. So here's where faith and logic come together. It may not have happened for you just yet. You may not have had to go through the fire and had a fourth man walking around in the fire with you just yet. You may not have been thrown into the lion's den just yet. Or maybe you see yourself being thrown into the lion's den, but you don't know what it's like when he makes the lion into a pillow for you just yet. You haven't been surrounded by your enemies on every side and looked around and said, I don't know what I'm going to do. And then seen God open your eyes and see that they that are for you far outnumber those that are against you. Just yet, you might not have had that in your life. But what I've come to tell you is God did a miracle for somebody in this place. If God's ever done a miracle for you, I want you to lift your hands. Listen. If you can't believe God for a miracle for yourself, let me just tell you that He is a healer. He's been a healer in my life. I've seen Him move. I've seen Him move mountains. I've seen Him say to those mountains, get out of the way, and they get cast into the sea. And if you can't believe for yourself today, I can believe for you today. But there's something special about just looking at a God who did it before and understanding that He's no respecter of persons and that He wants to do it for you today. And we can literally say, God, I don't know if you've done it for me yet, but I've seen you move mountains for somebody else, and I know you're a mountain moving God. So I know that, God, if I feel the heat getting turned up in my life, it's because you're getting ready to walk into a furnace with me. If I hear the roar of an enemy like a lion that's coming to steal, kill, and destroy, I know that, God, you're getting ready to make him into a pillow so I can rest my head. If I see my enemies gathered around me, God, I know that you're getting ready to prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemy. So I wonder if there's anybody in this room today that say, come on, devil, all you're doing is creating a way for God to be big in my life. So just bring the fight to me because I'm well able, because greater is he who's on the inside of me than he who's in this world. I've seen you move. I've seen you move mountains, and this is my confidence, God. I know you're going to do it again. Come on, somebody lift your voice and sing it. I've seen you move.
still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Oh, you never failed me yet. And I never will forget. Thank you.
in whatever situation may be going on there. He is there in the midst of it. All we have to do is stand strong on that firm foundation that we have built in Christ. And sometimes we may think we don't have that firm foundation, but you pull that Bible right back out. You open up the Word and you dig yourself in there until nothing comes out but Him. And He's just going to be like, oh.
Thankful that God doesn't know how to fail. We were talking on Wednesday night about how God is omniscient, and so He just knows everything. And we were talking about how that pertains to our lives. Does God know what we're going to do next? Does God know, does He give us those free choices or not? And we got into, you know, the theology of that. Does God know this, and does he constrain Himself to allow us the ability to make free choice, and then He knows the outcome there. And we really dove into those things, and I just got to thinking about that a minute ago, and I just realized, you know, we talk about the omniscience of God, but there's one thing I know that God doesn't know anything about. God, did y'all know that? God, there's one thing that I just thought about that God doesn't know. He doesn't know what it's like to lose. He has never been defeated. He's never lost a battle. Jesus struggled with all those things, but the Father God was in heaven saying, I got you, boy. I got you, son. And even when he turned his face away for just a moment, he knew the outcome, that Jesus was the lamb slain from the foundations of the world. And why is that so important to you and me today? Because I don't know about you, but I have suffered defeat several times in my life. I have walked away, nursing my wounds with certain situations, but God has never lost a battle. And if I lean into Him, I know that He is a foundation that will never be shaken. I know that Christ is the cornerstone, the chief cornerstone, that if I build upon Him, I know I'm never gonna fall. I'm never gonna fall so far that He can't pick me back up. Matter of fact, anytime I do fall, I find myself poised in a position that is the place He really wanted me to be anyway, where I could just surrender to Him and say, God, do it again. I've seen You move. You moved the mountains. Do it again, because You don't know how to fail. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise today. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, worship team. Amen. Amen. Happy Palm Sunday. Good to see some of you who were here on Palm Sunday. Get that reference. It's Palm Sunday today. Everybody wave your palms at me. Amen. It's Palm Sunday again. Good to be in the house of the Lord with you. And what does that mean for those of you who weren't here? These are our palms right here, and we get to wave them at the King of Glory every, not just Palm Sunday, but Palm Monday and Palm Tuesday and Palm Wednesday. We get the opportunity to lift up a praise to the only God who's worthy. And so we've come in again a week after Easter, and it's still Palm Sunday again. Amen. And next Sunday will be Palm Sunday again, and tomorrow's going to be Palm Monday. So whatever you need, these are your weapons of warfare right here. They're not carnal, but they're mighty through God to pull down strongholds and cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Amen. And these are the things that cause enemies to flee. When we lift these palms up and we say the name of Jesus and we say, Hosanna, come save us now. He comes on the scene and He's never lost a battle. Amen. Amen. Give the Lord one more hand clap of praise. Amen. So good to be in the house of the Lord with you. And at this time, we will dismiss our middle school students over here on the right side. I always do this really quick, and they seldom have time. There he is on it today. On time, Pastor Justin's over here, amen, and we will release the middle schoolers to go with him for middle school class today, and they are going to have a great time. To the book of Genesis, chapter number 27, we're going to read, and we are going to pray, and we are going to take the filter off. Somebody say, no filter. Genesis chapter 27, verse 15 says this, then Rebekah took the choice clothes of her elder son Esau, so mama's meddling, and she took the clothes of her oldest son Esau, which were there with her in her house, and she put them on Jacob, the younger son. And she put the skins of the kids of the goats, meaning the little baby goats, on his hands and on the smooth part of his neck. Anybody still got a smooth part of your neck? You know, I don't know if I have any smooth parts of my neck anymore, but he had smooth parts on his neck, and she put some goat hair on there. And then she gave the savory food and the bread to him, which she had prepared, into the hands of her son Jacob. Excuse me. And so he went to his father and said, my father. And he said, here I am. Who are you, my son? Now, all of a sudden, he's confused. Isaac is confused. He said, I am Esau, your firstborn. I have done just as you told me. Please arise, sit, and eat of the game that your soul may be blessed. But Isaac said to his son, how is it that you have found it so quickly, my son? And he said, because the Lord your God brought it to me. Now, just so you know, he's lying. He's lying. His mama made it. The Lord your God brought it to me. And Isaac said to Jacob, please come near that I may feel you, my son, whether you're really my son Esau or not. Now, Isaac is old in years. He can't see anymore. He's blind. And now he hears the voice of his younger son, Jacob. He's getting ready to pass on the blessing, knowing that he's getting ready to die. He's getting ready to pass on a blessing to his oldest son, his firstborn son. And many of you are familiar with this story. The two boys were essentially twins, and Esau came out first, and Jacob came out of the womb grabbing at the heels of Esau, saying, no, I want to be first. And from that point on, he was known as the heel grabber, the usurper, trying to get out ahead of his brother. And here's another such situation where they are faced with, where mom's meddling and getting involved with the situation. She is preferring Jacob over Esau, and she's trying to get Jacob the blessing that really belongs to Esau. And so she has put, you know, goat skin on him to make him hairy like his older brother. Now, I don't know why Esau, being just seconds older, was way hairier, but he was much hairier. And she is trying to make him up. And here's Isaac. He's at the end of his years, and he's got to distinguish if this is in fact his oldest son Esau or if it's Jacob, because he is really struggling in his mind. He says, I know the sound of Esau's voice. I know the sound of Jacob's voice. This sounds like Jacob. Let's read on. He says that. He said, see if this is my son Esau or not. Jacob went near to Isaac and his father, and he felt him. And he said, the voice is Jacob's voice, but the hands are the hands of Esau. And he didn't recognize him because his hands were hairy like his brother Esau's hands. So he blessed him. So he has efficiently fooled his dad now. He's efficiently fooled his dad, effectively fooled his dad. And he blesses him. And he said, and then he says, are you really my son Esau? He's asking him again. He's really perplexed about this. It's not really making sense. I'm feeling one thing. His senses were confusing him. And then he said, are you really my son Esau? And Jacob said, I am. He still held to the lie. Essentially, what was happening was something that we do a lot in our lives today. Now, we may not battle with our older siblings over the birthright. We may not battle with our older or younger siblings over who's going to get blessed by dad, because we live in a different society and a different culture today. But we very much deal with the same kind of thing. And we can look at Jacob and what he's doing today, and we can all kind of cast a little stone of judgment to him. But the reality is, many of us do this exact same thing on a regular basis. Many of us will take our lives that we're living and say, the life that I'm living right now is not the life that I want, so I'm going to put something else on. I'm gonna change the outer shell of myself or of my life, and I'm going to just try to present like I'm something different than what I am. That I believe in the church today, and not just this church, but this church isn't exempt. I believe in the church today, there are a bunch of people running around on this Sunday morning who have, they may not have goat's skin on them. They may not be wearing hair like that. They may not be have it on their hand, the back of their hands, and they may not be trying to trying to talk to a blind daddy somewhere, but they are in fact masquerading all over the church today. And there are some, you might have even come in today and you're not exactly pleased with who you are as a person. So you've tried to put on your Sunday best and you've tried to come in and masquerade as something today that you may not be. You may have come in and you're trying to put on this cloak that says, I'm fine. I've got it all together. Everything's fine. I'm good. But really, you are broken on the inside. You may have put on a good Sunday shirt, but really the heart underneath the shirt is broken into a million pieces. You may have put your makeup on real good. You may have combed your hair real nice, all five of them. Some of you guys combed them real good. And you know, I do mine until Deidre says it looks good, because she's the one that I'm trying to look good for. And you may have done yourself up real well, but in reality, you've got those hairs combed real nicely, but the mind underneath them is in torment. And so I want to come and talk to you today about filters. I want to talk to you about putting on filters, because that's essentially the equivalent of what Jacob did all those years ago. Will you pray with me today as I pray for you? Father, in Jesus' name, I pray that you would bless this word. God, that we could leave this place having been impacted by your word, that the Holy Spirit right now would go forth and bring increase to the word. God, Lord, we don't need to change a single thing about it, but God, we need you to change us. So Lord, I pray that you would use this word, God, to change our hearts, change our lives. And God, let us take our filters off and let us just be who you've uniquely called us to be. In Jesus' name, and the church said amen. And amen. We live in a world of filters. We live in a world of filters. Does anybody have Snapchat? Some of you are afraid to admit it. My wife just barely put her hand up. Amen. Throw her right under the bus. Snapchat is a world of filters. It's a place where you can do a picture, but you don't actually have to put a picture of you up there. They've got filters that can change everything. And some of us have taken this idea of filters that are in Snapchat world or other worlds, online worlds, and we have just tried to apply it to ourselves in our regular lives. There are people who, I think there's songs written about this that say, I'm so much cooler online. The online version of you is different than the version of you that's sitting in the chair today. I don't know who I'm talking to, but there's a lot of us that put on a persona. That's maybe you don't have Snapchat. Maybe you're an old school Facebooker. Maybe some of y'all still trying to dig up MySpace. But your online version of you is just the prettiest version of yourself. We'll do this. Any of you ladies take a picture 16 times before you actually choose the one that you're going to use and be like, okay, that's my bad side. Now that's my bad side. Change the angle, change the lighting, change the filter. Any of you ladies do that? Come on, transparency. You need to know if I'm preaching in the right place today. Now here's the question. How many of you guys do it? Pride goeth before the fall. Thank you, Brother Dave. Thank you, Brother Dave. Needed you, man. Because I'm going to tell you right now, if I put the phone up and I got a double chin on this side, I'm moving over to this side. Deidre says, you get over here because it's my good side. I'm like, I got both good sides. I can go either side, baby. Both sides are round. But we put on these filters, and the filter can change my... I need to talk because I'm elated today. It's a great day for me because the person who cuts this beautiful hair of mine is in the room with us. Avery's here today. I'm stoked to have her here. And if you don't like my hair, tell Eli. He's the complaint department. But You know, I love having a good fresh haircut, and I'm liable to do anything with my hair, and whatever pleases Deidre and Abby is what happens in this haircut, you know, in this head of mine. But you know, social media world and Snapchat world, you can throw a filter on and just change your hair altogether. You know, I could be bald. You know, I could look like Jedediah. Jedediah is Aaron, for those of you who don't know. But yeah, we could change our filter. We could put whatever we want to on ourselves, you know, and we can snap a picture. And, you know, I saw some people that I went to school with when I didn't realize things were filters, when they had made some of those filters so good. I went to school, I saw some pictures of some people I went to school with, and I'm like, she's aging backwards. Like, wow. Oh my gosh. And I'm like, Deidre, did you see this? Like, did she have some work done? Like, what happened? And Deidre goes, oh, that's a filter. And I'm like, you know, ruined the whole thing. Cause then I seen him without the filter, and I'm like, wow, wow, wow. Thank God for filters. No, that's not what today's about. It's the opposite. But we can throw on the filters, man. And you know what? The Holy Spirit really started talking to me last night in my 9.5-hour journey. And he started dealing with me, and he said, you know what a filter really is? He said, you need to tell your church this, Paul. A filter really is a wall. He said, you know, we build up walls. They're defense mechanisms oftentimes, and you know, they're the ways that we keep ourselves from getting hurt. But then sometimes we get strategic with our walls, and we don't make them out of, you know, 3 foot deep, you know, mortar and brick, and build them up where we can't see out and they can't see in. Sometimes we get strategic with the building of our walls. We make them super thin and we turn them into disguises. And then we can be right there in the presence of maybe our enemies or those who are, that we're afraid of, and we can be hiding behind a wall. So what a filter really is a bit of a wall. Just a really paper-thin wall, just a little wall to make you not be the person that God has really intended for you to be. We put spiritual filters on our lives all the time. We've been talking about natural filters, but we put spiritual filters over ourselves in just the same way all the time. We have several areas of our lives spiritually that we would like to shield others from seeing, or that we just don't want to really admit to people that we are living in. And I want to just dig in and kind of meddle in your business for just a minute today and talk about those things. There are a number of filters out there that are just made for smoothing the edges. That's the one that I saw with some of my people that I went to school with, you know, some of my old friends. They just smooth the edges. And I mean, it takes the things that are wrinkled and makes them smooth. You know, talking about the back of Jacob's neck being smooth, and, you know, it just smoothed it out. And sometimes we like to put that filter on if we've got a lot of wrinkles, or we've got maybe some scars, or we've got some things going on. We're not completely unhappy with where we are or who we are. We just don't like, you know, the small features of, you know, the intricacies. If, you know, I'm pretty pleased with who I am or where I am, taking this back to the filter, I'm okay with my face, basically, but it just would look better, smoother. Anybody, I don't want you to raise your hand if you relate to that. I relate to that. But so we just put that, you know, that filter on to just kind of smooth out the edges. And then we're like, look, that's me, but a better version of me. That's me, but I'm prettier. That's me, but I'm younger. And that's me without sunspots. Look, that's me without crow's feet. You know, that's me without that bad complexion. That's me with a tan. Everybody from Michigan said amen. All the snowbirds that just came back were like, everybody growl, okay? We may be making a more appealing picture when we do that. But those sunspots, those spiritual sunspots that we have, those all represent encounters that we've had with the sun. So we don't need to hide those spiritual sunspots. See, we do that. We do it in the natural, but we also do it in the spiritual. We don't want people to see really what kind of spirit man we have. We don't want to let people see spiritually our vulnerability. And those sunspots come from your encounters with God. Those spiritual crow's feet that you may have that you're trying to cover up and masquerade around, those spiritual crow's feet come from bowing your head in prayer and intercession. And you earn those. Those spiritual imperfections are the things that he's still working on. And we should all get to the place where we're not trying to hide the things that God is working on in our lives. This is really the core and the meat of what I want to talk to you about today, because we get so good at covering up the areas where God is trying to work in our lives. And we try to hide it from everybody. God's not working over here. Don't worry. Nothing to see over here. God's not doing anything. I'm already perfect. You don't got to worry about me. Just look the other way. In the meantime, God is trying to work on us, and we're hindering him like a makeup artist saying, come over here, cover this up. And every time God's got to keep doing the surgery on us, he's got to keep peeling away all the makeup that we're putting on to masquerade the thing that he's trying to work out in us. When I think it's time for the church to just get to the place where we can say, God is working on me. I understand that I'm not perfect. You need to understand that I'm not perfect as well. You need to quit putting me up on some kind of pedestal and letting me be the reason that you don't serve God. Listen, I know I'm messed up. I'm not just talking about me. I'm trying to encourage you. Some of you looking at me shaking your head like, I know you're messed up, Pastor. I'm talking about you, man. We need to get to the place where we're like, I know I don't got it all together. I'm working this thing out daily with fear and trembling. And God's working it out in me. I got a novel idea. Let's stop hiding that God's working on us, and let's start celebrating it, so that when we go from our trial to our triumph, everybody gets to see that. Look what God did in them. Look what God did through them. Every time we hide it, we rob God of a testimony. See, the reason we hide it is because we're not quite sure that we're ever going to get past it. We hide it because we don't have the faith that God's going to bring us through to the victory. We hide it so that just in case I can't get past it, then people won't know that I got it. But I'm telling you, for some of you, God is waiting on you to be vulnerable and let somebody hear what you're going through, because they're waiting on the word that's coming from you. They're waiting to hear that somebody else is dealing with what they're dealing with. And then when God does bring you through, they could say, I seen you move. You moved a mountain for them. I seen what you did in their life. And I see that they came from trial to triumph. I see that you brought them from the low place to the high place, God. And I know that if you did it in them, you can do it in me. But we keep on putting on the masquerade, and we keep telling people, hey, we're all perfect. And then people come in from the world and say, man, I just went to church this Sunday morning with a perfect church people, and I can never live up to that perfect expectation. So I'm just going to go find me somewhere else. Maybe the bar down the road will take me in and accept me for all of my problems, and they'll begin to speak to me in a way that I can understand, instead of being this this perfection that I see everybody trying to be in the church. And here's the thing. The world looks at the church and they say, I know it ain't real. I know it's not real. We get told all the time how the church is just full of hypocrites running around. And the reality is, I don't think people are trying to be hypocritical. They're just trying not to show off their mess. So they just try to clean it up and put a filter on it, so they're not showing off their mess. None of us want to show off our mess. But God turns our mess into messages. He turns our test into testimonies. And if we don't show them, then we can't show him. So I've just come to tell you today, it's time to take the filter off. It's time to take the filter off. You don't have to iron out the wrinkles. You don't have to take away the scars. You know, we put those filters to remove some scars that we may have.
And the reality is, those scars that you got, you earned those scars. You earned those. That scar, whether it's physical or spiritual, it represents a battle that you went through and you're still breathing. It represents something you came through that it didn't kill you. It had the propensity to kill you, but it didn't kill you. It left you with a scar. You know, this same guy that we're talking about, he had an encounter with God, left him with a limp. And he didn't get to walk away from that saying, man, I've been with God, so I'm healed. And bless God, I'm walking around great. No, God said, you've encountered me, and from now on, you're going to be limping because of the experience that you've had with me. And God didn't let him walk around without the limp. You need to understand those scars and those things that you keep trying to hide from people are the things that are going to help people get through the thing that they're trying to get through. You need to celebrate your scars because they represent that you didn't die. They represent the enemy couldn't kill you. The fact that you're here this morning still breathing means that God has a plan and a future for you. And he's got a design that he's worked out that he wants to use those scars to minister to somebody. Somebody should say amen right there. We may be able to put on a nice little picture, but I don't think people are interested in the fake version of us. You know, anybody ever heard the term getting catfished? I'm just going to bring it out. Some of you have no idea what I'm talking about. Being catfished is when you meet someone online and then you meet them in person and it ain't the same person. And generally, it's a term that's used for like dating. So you got your online dating profile, and you know, and you've got the perfect version of you on there, or the other person has their perfect version, and then when you go meet them in person, you meet up, you go to the restaurant or whatever, and you see a person sitting there at the table, and that's where they told you they'd be sitting, but it's not the person that was in the face, you know, in the profile. That's being catfished, okay? We as church people keep catfishing people. We keep trying to tell them, come into church because look at me, I'm perfect. This is my best picture. And then when they get here and all of a sudden they start seeing, they get involved in the church and then they start seeing, wait a minute, that person ain't nothing like they were acting like they were supposed to be. Spiritually, they're a mess. They're a wreck. We need to quit catfishing people. We need to get rid of the filter. Everybody say hashtag no filter. Amen. Sometimes we don't want to just smooth the edges. Sometimes we want a whole new identity. You can take a picture of yourself and it be something completely different. I don't even know. I don't have Snapchat. I'm speaking in third person. I have really no evidence for this other than what I've seen, in other people. But you know, the way I've seen it, like you can take a picture of yourself and you can be the Wonder Bread man. I don't know what, obviously I'm talking out of turn, but you can change who your complete identity. And that is something that's rampant in the world today. Because now we've got people who don't just want to iron out the edges. They don't want to just get rid of the wrinkles. They want like a whole new identity. Matter of fact, we're living, many of you know this, we're living in a world where people are constantly trying to change their identity altogether. They're trying to change their gender. They're trying to change their sexuality. They're trying to change, you know, how they act, how they dress. We have terrible doctors that are giving people medicine to change their biology, messing with the plan and design of God. And listen, I know I'm getting off into areas that may be touchy for some of you, but can I say I love getting off into these areas, not because I want to beat up on anybody or put anyone down, but it's literally from my heart I'm crying out to say to you that God made you fearfully and wonderfully. He's got a plan and a purpose for you exactly exactly how you are. He didn't mess up on you. He didn't just miss it with you. I'm telling you, please hear my heart today. It's not about me beating up anyone. It's about me telling you that you, just the way you are exactly how God designed you to be. You're perfect. And you may not feel perfect. You may have bought into lies, and you may be trying to put on filters, and you may be trying to do different things to try and change who you are. But I've come, if you've heard the lies long enough, I just want to tell you the truth. You are beautiful. You are perfect just the way that you are. You say, well, I'm not perfect by the world standards. We don't live by the world standards. You don't have to live by the world standards. If your creator says that you are beautiful, then you are beautiful. There's nothing you can do about it. And you are made in his image. But we'll try and take on a whole new identity. Let's talk about what that looks like. Let's talk about what that looks like spiritually. We won't try to just kind of cover up some spiritual weaknesses. We'll try to put on a hat like we are somebody in the spirit. Like we are able to speak into people's lives, and we keep messing up people's lives because we don't get our own lives together first, and we keep trying to speak into other people's lives. We keep trying to be a prophet to somebody, trying to put on a whole identity that God hasn't given you, and trying to speak into their lives, and trying to tell them how to do what they, you know, what did somebody say? Said, clean your own house before you start coming and scrutinizing mine. You know, and we've got a whole bunch of people that just put on a whole new office. They put on a whole new identity. Boy, I'm the prophet. I'm the prophetess today. Let me tell you about what you're doing wrong. We keep causing people to stumble instead of lifting one another up, all because we put on a completely whole new identity. And then the third thing that we do, and you can do with filters, is we put on somebody else's identity. So we're not just putting on some third party identity. We'll put on, you can make yourself, I don't know, there's probably a filter out there. You can take a picture of yourself, make yourself, you know, face swap with somebody. Anybody ever seen the face swap one? You can just face swap with somebody. They probably got a filter out there. You can just, you know, filter it up and be Justin Bieber or somebody. And you know, we'll take on a whole or somebody else's identity. The enemy is so cunning that he would have you believe that you're better off trying to emulate somebody else than be who God has called you to be. Spiritually speaking, we are trying all the time to reproduce our spiritual leaders. There are people in this room today, and I'm praying for you, by the way, because you'll understand here in a minute. There are people in the room today say, if I could just be like Pastor Paul, if I could just, you know, have his identity, if I could have his family and his kids, and y'all don't know the kind of mess that's going on up here. But you're like, if I could just, you know, if my family could be like Pastor's family, then we would, you know, then life would be great. Boy, they've got it all together, you know, and all the, and listen, I'm not going to lie. God, we got a great blessed family, and I'm thankful for it, but you can too. And you don't have to be me to get it done. All you have to be is his to get it done. And then he'll give you an identity that's incredible. And people will begin to look at you and say, look at that family. Look what they've done. Look at the restoration that God has done in that family. Can I tell you, listen, I just want to testify for a second. I don't come from a pedigree of church people. I come from a dad who was drunk and spent time in the bars and, you know, and just lived that lifestyle, who was absent for all of my childhood. Listen, I'm not throwing him under the bus. I guess I am, but he knows I love him, you know, just spent some time with him yesterday, and God saved him. But I don't come from some pedigree. I don't come from, you know, I'm not a preacher's kid. I was down with some family just yesterday for a funeral, and we were talking about how, you know, our great granddad was a bootlegger on the Mississippi River, and, you know, and all of that, those type of things. I've got no pedigree. Like, I've got, and people look at our family and say, man, look at how good of a godly family they are. All that means is that we surrendered our lives to God, and we did it in this generation. This isn't multi-generations deep. It's not because of something somebody else did. We just made a choice, Deidre and I, that we were going to love the Lord God with all our heart and mind and soul and strength, and we were going to give him all of ourselves. And when we did that, he said, you know what? That's some people that I could bless. But the thing is, he doesn't just respect us. We're not, you know, we're not somebody special, more special than you in the eyes of God. God is looking for a whosoever. He's looking for you, mom and dad, to make a decision that you'll quit straddling the fence, or you'll quit trying to be somebody else, that you'll take the filter off and say, God, just do in me what I know you can do in me, and let me be a model that other people will look to. Amen. Somebody needs to shout amen right there and say, God, do that in me. We don't need to put somebody else on. We don't need to put on a different identity. Because the identity that God has for you, my God, the whole substance of the message today is, if we could get everybody to be who you are, if we could just get you to be who you are, if God could just get you to be who he's called you to be, not who he's called me to be, not who he's called me to want you to be, not who you'd like to be, but who he's called you to be. Not some other version. See, Jacob constantly wanted to be Esau. He wanted to be the firstborn. He wanted to have the blessing. Instead of embracing who he was, instead of just understanding that God had a great destiny for him anyway, he just constantly wanted to be somebody else. He wanted to be his brother. And I'm just... From my heart today, I'm just telling you, if you could just be who God is calling you to be, we would set the world on fire. We would change. Listen, through God, we would change Battle Creek. We'd change Calhoun County. I mean, we would do what no church has been able to do, because we would be authentically ourselves, and we would go out and just conquer the entire world. I'm telling you, there was 11 men. They were called the disciples. They were unlearned. They were boys. They were young. But they had an authentic encounter with God, and they turned the world upside down. The reason we're here today is because of those 11 boys who didn't know any better, but just let God be God in their lives. And they toppled kingdoms. The Roman Empire fell. The Roman Empire fell really at the hands of 11 unlearned fishermen boys, because they let God be God in their lives. They didn't try to be somebody else. Can you imagine if John was trying to be Peter? Can you imagine what would happen if the disciples were trying to just live vicariously through one another? We'd have had a whole church mess and a church implosion, and the church wouldn't even be around today. But they let God do what only he could do in their lives, and that's what we need to do today. The last thing that we use filters for a lot of times is to change the surroundings. We kind of green screen ourselves. Maybe we're okay with who we are, but we're not okay with where we are, where we are. We're okay with who we are, but we're not okay with where we are. Now I want to get with you spiritually for just a second. This really, if you allow it, this will really speak to you today. Because you could say, God, I'm pretty comfortable with where you have, like, with who you have me as right now. I know that you're working it out. I can be vulnerable. I can do all those things pastors ask me to do. But I'm not real comfortable with where I am spiritually. Because, God, I know that you have better things for me. And spiritually, I'm in kind of a dark place. Spiritually, I'm in kind of a cold place. Spiritually, I'm in a barren place. And so, God, I really just don't want them to see me. I know that on the horizon, you've got this, you know, this great, luscious green pastures for me, God, but that's not where I'm at right now in life. And so I'm just going to put on a filter so people can see me where I'm going. They can see, you know, what it'll be like for me up ahead. But I don't want them to see me in this place where I'm at. The reality is, I know I'm strong in the Lord, but right now my family's a mess. The reality is, I know who I believe in. I know that you're mine and I'm yours, God, but I'm on the verge of losing my job. The reality is, God, I'm strong as a Christian. I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to serve you. But I've been fighting with all kinds of my friends. I've been struggling in relationships. God, I feel like I'm good. I'm going to serve you forever. But I've been really critical of church people lately, and really judgmental. And I don't want people to see me where I'm at. So I keep putting a filter over where I'm at. I keep telling people when they ask me, how are you doing? I just keep telling them, I'm good. We're good. All's well. You know, God's good. He's got me. You know, and we put that filter on. Some of you are sick in your body and you refuse to say it. Some of you are dealing with things and you're like, you know what? No, I'm good because, you know, my faith. I'm just going to not say it. I'm just going to not, you know, give it voice. But we don't know how to pray with you. We don't know how to intercede on your behalf. And we keep trying to cover up the where we are in life. You know, some of the greatest church people that I've ever met, some of the sweetest, most meek, Holy Ghost-filled church people have they've had to traverse broken families on their own because they just didn't want to let anybody know that my family's kind of a mess right now, that the enemy's really working in my children right now. That they get afraid because they've been living for the Lord for all their life, and now they've got a son or a daughter or a grandson or a granddaughter that's come out and identified with some other sexual orientation or some sexual preference or something, and they're like, I don't want to talk about that. I don't want to give that any place because I gotta put a different scenery up because I've been living, you know, my life is a godly life, and so I've got to put a different screen, you know, I got to green screen this. I got to put myself somewhere else. When in reality, God uses those barren places. God uses those broken places. We keep robbing God of opportunities to be big in our lives by covering up where we are. We keep robbing God the opportunity to show us how to be victorious and show others how he can be big in us. The scripture says that his strength is made perfect in my weakness. And we keep trying to not be vulnerable. We keep trying to not be weak. We keep trying to not only not show our weaknesses, but we don't want to show our family weaknesses. We don't want to show our social weaknesses. We don't want to be transparent about anything in our lives. And so we just keep on putting filters on. But I want to talk to you about something that God is interested in. He's interested in the unfiltered you. God is interested in the unfiltered you. Regardless of the reason that you might feel pressure to put on a spiritual filter, I've come with the word of the Lord today to tell you that there's no filter needed in your life. Look what Psalms 139, verse 14 says. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made, and marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made, the scripture says. Look what Genesis 1:27 says. So God created man in his own image, in the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. So the scripture tells us two things here. One, that God created us fearfully and wonderfully. He created us with respect and reverence. Wonderfully, he created us. But that he didn't just create us wonderfully and fearfully. He created us in his own image. In his own image. And so this is what the unfiltered you looks like. The unfiltered you looks like your daddy. The unfiltered you looks like your daddy. And I'm not talking about your earthly daddy. I don't know where he's at today. Jess said hallelujah if you're watching. Just want to. But you look a lot like your dad. Sorry, I had to. You look a lot like your dad. And you know, I get told all the time that Eli has to be my son. You know, they say he looks a lot like his daddy. But let me tell you something. How he looks does not determine that he's mine or not. That outer shell that you see, that perfect smile for us. That doesn't determine that he's mine, really. You know how I know that Eli's my son? You know how I know that Wyatt's my son? He acts like me. Ask his mama. That's how I know he's my son. Because he acts like I do. His actions are the same as my actions. It's uncanny and sometimes terrifying. Arguing with him is like arguing with myself. I feel schizophrenic at times. His mannerisms are the same as my mannerisms. There are people who hang out with us in different ways, different times. I think Ashlyn said the other day, she said, that's exactly how Eli would have said that. Oh my gosh. Like, and I'm like, yeah, I take after him. Here's the big part. His spirit is my spirit. My spirit is his spirit. And listen, the same is true of Eli, but the same is true of Wyatt. He acts like his daddy. His actions are my actions. He's starting to argue just like his daddy. I mean, the kid's logic is ridiculous. His spirit is the same spirit that's in me. And here's the thing that we should be asking ourselves today. What does the unfiltered you look like, really? The unfiltered you looks a lot like your dad. If you'll allow the unfiltered you to just come through, it's not necessarily about the aesthetics. You were made in his image. You were created fearfully and wonderfully in his image. But it's about your actions. Are your actions his actions? Are your mannerisms his mannerisms? Are you doing on a daily basis what you know God would do? Jesus literally said this to his disciples. I only do what the Father tells me to do. I only say what the Father tells me to say. What he was saying is, I know I'm his boy. I know I'm his son. The dove descended and a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. But Jesus didn't say I'm his son because I look like him. He didn't say I'm God's son because I can put on a filter to look godly. He said, I do what he does. I say what he says. I'm about my Father's business. And so I am his. I'm in his image. And so the unfiltered you looks like your dad. If you'll allow him, if you'll allow yourself to, you will begin to do the things your dad does. And you'll begin to say the things your dad says. And you'll begin to act the way your dad acts. And you'll begin to love the way the Father loves. And you'll begin to have grace like
the Father has grace, and you'll begin to have compassion like God has compassion, and you'll begin to look at other people the way that God looks at other people instead of through eyes of judgment, through eyes of mercy. You'll begin to see things the way God sees things, and you'll begin to be so much more like your Father. So what I'm telling you today is it's time for the church to take the filters off and start being unfiltered and be like our Father. Be fearfully and wonderfully created in the image of God, and act like Dad, and be like Dad, and walk like Dad, and talk like Dad, and give love like Dad, and give compassion like Dad, and be merciful like Dad, and just walk around and be who Dad has called us to be. Stand to your feet with me today. Let me tell you why there's no filter needed in your life. There's no filter needed for you because you are a priceless work of art, just the way you are. Has anybody seen the Mona Lisa up close? Yeah, a handful of people. She ain't real pretty. But that painting of that woman is one of the most priceless works of art. Not because of her aesthetics, not because of what she looks like. The value of the Mona Lisa has nothing to do with how pretty Mona Lisa is. And I say thank God, because your value has nothing to do with how pretty you are. It has everything to do with the artist who was making the image and the value that the artist placed on the creation. It has everything to do with who made the Mona Lisa. That's why it's valuable. You are a priceless work of art, exactly how you are. Can you imagine the art, whatever art institute the Mona Lisa's at, and you just go in to see it, and it's behind, you know, however thick a glass, and you get to see the Mona Lisa. But every day they've got, you know, on Thursdays it's unwrinkled skin Mona Lisa filter. You know, on Wednesdays, on Tuesdays, it's Mona Lisa eating a taco. And you get the filtered version of the Mona Lisa. You'd be like, man, I got gypped. I came to see the Mona Lisa and I got some filtered version. And I'm not interested in how beautiful the Mona Lisa is. I'm interested in looking at the work that the Creator put into the Mona Lisa. I don't want to see a filtered version of the Mona Lisa. I just want to see the authentic, real Mona Lisa. I just want to see what I've come to see. And that's how we've got to start being in our own life. People do not want to see some filtered version of you. They want to see the tapestry of God. They want to see God's fingerprints on you. They want to see what His hand, what His brush is doing in your life. And you are so priceless just the way you are. You are robbing them and you are robbing God of a testimony by not letting people see the real you. So I say it's time to take the filters off. I'd say it's time for Dexter Lake to take the filters off of who we are. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. It's time to take the filters off. Have you ever considered that while you're being fake, someone else is looking to you for authenticity? Have you ever considered that? Somebody needs what's on the inside of you. Somebody needs what's authentically you. Somebody needs something that probably only you can provide. A testimony of, I've been through this, I know what you're going through. And we're robbing them of
of that opportunity. So I say we take the filters off. I say as a church, let me make one disclaimer before I close today. I'm not saying that we glorify sin. I'm not saying that we glorify our problems. I'm not talking about glorifying our problems. I'm just talking about not hiding them. I'm not talking about glorifying being a mess. I'm not saying, look how messed up I am. I won this week. Like, it's not a race of who's the most messed up from here on out. But what I'm talking about is not hiding that stuff and showing other church people and showing the world, most importantly, showing the world that I can love God and He can love me and work out my mess at the same time. I think that we can literally get to the place where we could say, man, I've been doing this thing for 20 years and I'm still battling with road rage. I mean, I'm authentic about, I'm transparent about that every week. I'm doing it because confession is good for my soul. I'm sorry if you've honked at me or, you know, some of you have flipped me off. I'm not mad. But we need to be transparent about the things that we're going through so God can work in our lives. So that God can get glory out of what we are doing and what He's bringing us through. So quit robbing God and quit robbing people. That's what I'm saying this morning. Let God see the authentic you. Will you bow your heads and close your eyes with me today? Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for the opportunity to come and share your word. God, it's our Reach Sunday, God. And Lord, I thank you that we have the opportunity to reach into the lives of all those who are here today. And we get to say to them through reaching, God loves you just the way you are. He's got a you that's changed. God's got a version of you that's different than you are right now. But He wants to be the painter. He wants to be the one that's changing you. He doesn't want you to put on something artificial. So Lord, I pray today that you would strengthen us. Give us boldness, God. Give us the courage to walk in our unique identity. And let you work out the details of our life as you see fit, Holy Spirit. Let you work it out in us, Christ. Lord, we'll give you praise and glory through the whole process. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Here's what I want to do before we leave today. We're not going to bow our heads and close our eyes or anything like that. I believe, I'm naive enough to believe that most everybody that's probably here today, you kind of clean up one part of your life or another. I've touched you with the Word of God this morning. The Word of God, rather, has touched you in some spot of your life. And I think probably 100% of us could really get on board with this if we'll allow the Holy Spirit to do it in our lives. But I just want you, if you're willing, as we leave this place today, to say, God, I just want to take the filter off. And I'm gonna be transparent and vulnerable. I'm gonna let you work through me. It doesn't mean I'm gonna noise my sin out to the world. That's not the idea. It's not just to glorify sin. But God, I want to be vulnerable enough. Let me show you what vulnerability is, just so you know. It's standing up here and saying, yes, I'm a child of God. I'm a preacher of the gospel. But I came from a broken home. I was raised in a trailer park. You know, I came from this, and being raised in a trailer park is not sinful. It's just where I came from. But being transparent about where God has brought us from, being transparent about the fact that we're not better than somebody else, that God that does things in me can do things for you as well. About not putting on some stained glass masquerade and just pretending to be something that we're not. Sometimes it's being vulnerable enough not glorifying sin, but saying, I am God's. I know I'm a child of God, but I've been really dealing with temptation in my life in this area. And going to a handful of your friends in confidence and just saying, I need to be vulnerable. I need to just say to you as accountability partners, I want to be vulnerable that I'm struggling with this area in my life. You know, for some of you ladies, it's about being confident in the place where you are in the Lord and not trying to change the circumstances surrounding you. Some of you are hurting. Some of you would say, I'm believing God for my child, but my child hasn't come in yet. And I'm saved. And this goes for men too, but I'm saved. I love the Lord, but my children are unsaved. And I need to be vulnerable and let people see that so that they can pray with me. And so that when God does bring them in, that's a testimony. I'm giving you practical application before we go so that you know what I'm talking about. And I could go down the list. I could talk on and on, but you know, you basically know these areas that you put a filter up. And I just wonder, with no heads bowed and no eyes closed, if you would say, I'm ready to take the filters off of my life. I'm ready to get rid of some of the filters that I'm blocking people from seeing. I'm not saying I'm going to glorify my sin. I'm not going to say I'm not going to make a spectacle out of all the bad things that I do. I just want to be vulnerable enough to let people see that God is still working in my life. Father, you see every hand that's raised up right now, and I pray that you would touch them and minister to them in such a powerful way, God, that they, when they leave this place today, God, they begin to become the walking testimony of Jesus Christ, God, that we would see the outcome of a beautiful change, that we allowed the painter that's painting our lives to just begin to tweak on us and paint the intricacies of beauty into our lives, God, and we would do it, God, where people could see, and that the test would become a testimony, God, that the mess would become a message, Lord, and that the trial would become a triumph, God, in our lives, and Lord, that we could give all glory back to you by taking the filter off and emulating our dad, God, by being like you and speaking like you and walking like you and talking like you and doing what you would do and giving mercy like you give mercy, God, and giving compassion on who you would give compassion to and loving our neighbor, God, and preferring one another over ourselves. God, let us do what you would do. Let us have the unfiltered version of ourselves in Jesus' name. Everybody shout amen and amen. One last thing before I close and we go today with, I do want you to bow your heads and close your eyes. I don't want a day to go by without giving an opportunity for somebody to receive Jesus into their heart. And we want to, why do I have people bow their heads and close their eyes? Just to make it easier for a person to make that decision. You know, the devil right now is attacking someone. You know what? Look at me before we close our eyes. I want you to understand this. There's a reason we do these methods. The devil currently, right now, is attacking somebody in this church, saying, don't do it. You'll be embarrassed. Saying, don't do it. You're not ready. Your life's not ready. You're a mess. All these different things. The enemy is just talking right now in their eyes. And so when I have you bow your heads and close your eyes, it's just to try to break the ice. It's just to try to make it that much easier for a person who the devil is just working on them. To just make it that much easier for them to be able to respond to the call of the Holy Spirit in their life. That's why we do it. So bow your heads and close your eyes. If you're here and the enemy's talking to you saying, don't do it, but you know God is talking to you saying, do it. Give your life to me. Surrender your heart to me. Surrender your life to me, and I'll make your life different. I'll make your life better. I will make your life be a life of godliness. I'll take those things away from you. I'll take those addictions. I'll take those hidden sins. I'll take the things that the enemy's just constantly on you about, and I'll work them together for good. If you're here today and you say, I'm ready. I need to give my life to God. I need to give my heart to God. I need to make him the Lord of my life. Will you raise your hand? Every head bowed and every eye closed right now. There are some hands going up. You're not alone in this place today. I need to give God my life today. I need to. I don't care what the enemy says. I need to give God my heart and my life. Come on, 3 seconds. I'm just going to give you a little bit of time. I want to just pray with you. I'm not even going to call you out of your seat. I just want to pray with you. put your hands down. Everybody look at me this way. Wednesday night, we finished up a teaching on salvation, what it means to be saved. And I said, there's a reason I don't do a you pray with me, repeat after me prayer on Sunday mornings. It's because repeating a prayer after me does not save you. You saying what I say does not matter. God is not interested in you quoting some words. God is interested in your heart. And the scripture, I could quote out a bunch of them. Repentance is necessary. It means we gotta turn away from our sin. It says that we have to surrender to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, meaning we don't make our own decisions anymore. He makes our decisions. But then it says this, and they that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So let me tell you, if you will repent of your sins, meaning I turn away, I change my mind, I'm not going to do sin anymore. You ask God into your heart, whatever that looks like for you. Say, God, live in me. You can have my heart. I surrender to your Lordship. And you call on the name of the Lord Jesus. Because it's his name, Jesus' name, is the only name given under heaven whereby men can be saved. Those are the things that you must do. And that's how God comes and abides in your heart and becomes the Lord of your life. I'm going to pray for you today. And I want you to pray a prayer of allowing God to be your Lord as I pray for you today. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray that you would come into those lives of the people who have raised their hand today. God, no less than four people have raised their hand and said, I don't want to listen to the enemy anymore. I don't want to go the directions that he's trying to get me to go, God. I want to serve you. I want to be yours. I want to be saved, God. Save me by the power of Jesus' name. I repent of my sin, and I call you Lord. God, I want you to change my life. You, God, do the painting on my life, God. And I surrender to you in Jesus' name. God, I pray that you would touch them and minister to them, that you would save them to the uttermost, God, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you all for coming and being a part of church this week. And we have... Justin, thank you. I was thinking it was Mike and Jane this week. Pastor Justin's going to close us in prayer today. Amen.
A time in the presence of the Lord. Amen. I don't know about you, but every week keeps getting better, and it's just so cool to see so many new faces. So greet somebody as you're leaving. But today I also wanted to take a second with our tithe and offering and just say this is our last form of worship for the moment, for this morning. And so we're going to receive that tithe and that offering. And, you know, there are in the receptacles, you can put those in those corners on your way out. We also do online giving. But if you would, like we do, if you would hold your phone, your tithe, your envelope, whatever that you, however you give in your hand, and we're going to hold that up and just as a way of dedicating that to the Lord. Lord, this is yours. God, I give this to you. And I pray that you would multiply it and that it would go toward ministry, that people would be saved, that people would come to know Jesus because of it. So right now, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for all that you've given. God, literally everything that we have is because of you. And God, it's my honor to give back today. I pray that you would bless this tithe and this offering today, God. Bless our week as we go. Give us the courage to talk to others, to tell others about everything that you're doing here at Dexter. And God, we just feel so blessed and thankful for all that you're doing. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.